The Upanishad series, transformation of sex energy. Sex is energy, so I would not say it is sexual energy. There is no other energy, but you have known it only as sex energy. Energy can be transformed and become higher energy. The higher it moves, less it will be sexual, or anything sexual will remain in it. And at the peak, it becomes simply love and compassion. The ultimate flowering we call divine energy. But the base, the seed remains sex. So sex is the beginning, the lowest layer of energy. Energy moves into different layers. This is the lowest layer of energy. It is the first and the lowest. And God or love is the topmost layer. But erroneously, out of ignorance, we consider the love as sex and we do not make a difference between the two. If we look at the water supply in our house, water is needed for different purposes. It needs for watering the plants. It needs for washing the yard. It needs for taking a shower. It needs for cooking your meals. So we identify these taps from where this water is being made available to you by different names. The water supply is basically the same, but when you take the water from the tap that is meant for watering the plants, you will not take the water from that source for the purpose of cooking your meals. Maybe there we have put some filters in the kitchen. If we consider these are different layers and the water is coming from the same source in your restroom, but you cannot take the water from there for drinking purposes. Maybe there is no filter there. And the kitchen, it is the environment, the surrounding that makes a difference. In the restroom, the area is being used for a different purpose. So that water cannot be used. It gets contaminated by the surroundings. Maybe the germs that are floating there, it may have its influence there. If we understand this, then we are not dividing it. We have made a different purpose and installed the water supply in the house in a specific way. If we consider human body as a house, a seven-storied house, these seven stories refer to various layers of consciousness, various psychocenters, and it has been installed in such a meticulous manner that all the purposes of the body is fulfilled. Just as in your house there are various needs for the water, so water has to be made available at different layers in different ways. In the same way, this energy that is in our body is needed for different purposes. It needed for continuation of the life force, digestion, and many other purposes. So this has to be understood, that these are the different functions that the energy has to perform in the body. So you do not divide it. Once you divide, then duality is created. Once you divide, then conflict and struggle is created. Once you divide energies, you are divided. And you will become against sex. Can you say in any way that the restroom is not needed in the body, in the house? Or if you have a garden, is a garden tap is not needed in the house? All these things are necessary. This is part of the whole plan of the system. So do not divide it. And if you are divided, then you will be for or against. You may want to have the restroom tap in the house or the garden tap, and someone may not want to have this. I am neither for nor against, because there is no need to divide. If I say sex is energy, sex is the way the energy at its base is recognized as. Just as the water supply that comes for the garden is known as garden tap. We have a specific taps. Looking at that, you can know that this is a garden tap. It is not an expensive one, but the tap that we use in the restroom, it can be fancy, it can be expensive, but the one that we use in the kitchen area is totally different. So the outlet through which the water supply is made available for different purposes differs. That much difference can be seen. Sex is the way the energy at its base is recognized as. You can call it X energy. Sex is the name of that X energy, the unknown energy. When you are using it as a biological reproduction force, you are using it as biological reproduction force and also for the fulfillment of the bodily needs. It becomes divine once it is freed from the biological bondage. Once it becomes non-physical, then it is the love of Jesus or the compassion of Buddha. It again depends upon, as I said, in case of the water supply, the source from where it comes in. It gives the water supply. The pipeline continues in the entire house. A connection is made, and for the water to be released, it is outside the house. We immediately call it garden tap. So the plumber makes it that this place will be the garden tap. Here will be another tap, this will be another, so on and so forth. So when the energy is used for reproduction and for fulfillment of biological needs, it is known as sex energy. It becomes divine once it is freed from the biological bondage. Once it becomes non-physical, then it is the love of Jesus and the compassion of Buddha. I am speaking to you, what is this? It is the energy which in Sufi terminology we call it tawajjuh. My attention is towards all those people who are connected to this live broadcast, those who will listen to it afterwards. It is connected to all of those. And it is for the transformation of those people that is broadcast. So it is the inner beauty. It is the inner harmony. It is the inner oneness that assumes the form of words. It is the inner music. When all the inner orchestra are in harmony with one another, there is no conflict. And out of that harmony, when a melody is flows, melody flows, it is the message. Music is the mystical wine. One of my couplet is, Bahut kadbi hai mai is saki ki. Indeed, bitter is the mystical wine of this brewer. Bahut kadbi hai mai is saki ki. Rang laegi ghar saanson mein utar aane. Certainly, it will create miracles if you allow to enter your breath, become part of you. It is the compassion of Buddha or the love of Jesus that this energy has been transformed. Many examples I can go on giving. You have a mango plant. The mango is coming in season. The flowering has begun. Then, as the flower dies, small mango starts appearing. And if you taste, its taste is neither bitter nor sour, not sweet. There is a particular name in Hindi. It's a typical taste which is known as kasala taste. When it continues to grow, it becomes sour. Young mango is very sour. And when the same mango, if it remains on the tree, and the process of growth or process of transformation, we have to use the word growth in case of the plant, and in case of the human consciousness, we will call it transformation. So with the energy of the sun and the moon, when they balance one another, sun is masculine energy, moon is feminine energy, the animus. When they balance one another, and in that balance, the fruit gets ripe. It is no more sour. It becomes tasty and sweet. The sweetness that was once sourness, it is out of the sourness the sweetness has come. It is out of the biological needs of that energy When that energy fulfills the biological needs and you are no more interested by your biology, then sex is transformed. It has ripened. It has become compassion. It is not needed in an awakened one. Awakened means his energies has been awakened. There is no need for the manifestation of energy at that level, the biological needs. It has become totally non-physical. This is difficult to understand, but we understand in terms of the mango fruit. But if we can understand and go deeper into it, one day traversing along life's routes, you realize you are not interested in sex anymore. It has transformed, it has manifested in a different form, maybe as compassion, maybe as a creative art. The more creative you are, that's a higher energy, the manifestation of the higher energy. Your interest in the lower forms will start getting less and less. The West is much obsessed today because of Christianity. 2000 years of Christianity has suppressed sex energy and made the Western mind too much obsessed with it. First, for 2000 years, the human mind was obsessed how to destroy it. You can neither kill it nor destroy it. The energy cannot be destroyed. This is a basic scientific fact. It can only be transformed. No energy can be destroyed. Certainly energy can be transformed, and there is no way to destroy it. Nothing can be destroyed in this world. It can only be transformed. What happened? Did the sourness of the mango was destroyed? And we took the injection and injected the sweet syrup in it. I heard in India and in the, according to one of the Indian sweets, it is called jalebi. It is made by spiral, a design. Then it is fried and soaked in this sugar syrup. So a white man was watching the man making the jalebi. He found it was very tasty. So he asked, how do you make it? So the poor man did not know how to explain it in English, but he used the broken English. He said, sir, artist make it, because it was an artistic looking like an artistic piece, a spiral. And artist make it, then doctor syringe inject juice. He meant that he do not know how to explain that when the hot piping hot the spiral piece comes out and dipped in the sugar syrup, it immediately absorbs the syrup. Explains that. It is not that the something was taken out from the mango and something else was added. It is the transformation of the sourness of the mango that has become the sweetness, sweet mellow. When you are no more interested in the release of the energy at the biological needs, for the biological needs, it reaches to the different level, it gets transformed. Nothing is destroyed in the world. In this cosmos, only it can be transformed, changed, move into a new realm and dimension. Destruction is impossible. You cannot create a new energy. You cannot destroy the old. Creation and destruction are both beyond you because these two things have not been placed in your hands. They cannot be done. Now, scientists agree to this. Not even a single atom can be destroyed. For 2000 years, Christianity was ruthlessly trying to destroy the sex energy. Religion consisted of becoming absolutely without sex that created madness. The more you fight, the more you suppress, the more sexual you become, and then sex moves deeper into your unconscious and subconscious layers. Then it begins to poison your whole being, your thoughts, your gestures. It is said there are 90,000 subtle gestures in meditation. So what happens when sex enters into the unfulfilled, enters into subconscious and unconscious layers? The gestures gets affected by it. So if you read the lives of the Christian saints, you will see they are obsessed with it. They cannot pray and meditate. Whatsoever they do, sex comes in, and they think that the devil is playing the tricks with them. Nobody plays the tricks. If you suppress something, then the suppression itself becomes devilish. After 2000 years of continuous sex suppression, the West became fed up with it. The suppression was too much. The whole wheel turned. Now, instead of repression, indulgence became another obsession. From one pole of the mind, they moved to another pole. But the disease remained the same. Once it was repression, now it is how to indulge more and more into it. But both are sick attitudes. The basic thing is, this energy has to be transformed, neither repressed nor madly indulge. The only possible way to transform sex is to be sexual with deep meditative awareness. If during the act at the physical level, you are meditative, the process of transformation begins. It is just the same as I was saying about anger. Move into sex, but with an alert, conscious, mindful being. Do not allow sex to become an unconscious force. Do not be pulled or pushed by it. Move knowingly, understandingly, and lovingly whenever the opportunity is there. But make this experience a meditative experience. The moment this experience becomes meditative, you can transcend. Meditate in it. This is what East have known as Tantra. The involvement in the act of sex with total awareness meditatively. Tantra is the art of going through the sex experience, and during this experience you are a witness. You are, for instance, now as state comes in, I am speaking, you are hearing it. So it may be said that I am speaking and you are hearing. No, there is something within me that knows that a process of speaking is happening, and it is happening in a state of passivity. The inner harmony is assuming the form of words. This is on my part. It has its mystical effect because it is emerging out of inner harmony and oneness. And when you begin to listen to it in a state of passivity, then listening becomes complete. The moment you start listening to this message in a state of passivity means totally relaxed, you are not making any effort. It automatically dissolves into your being. Then you are a witness to it. And once you are meditative in sexual experience, its quality starts changing. The same energy which was moving into sexual experience starts moving towards consciousness. You can become so alert at the peak of the sexual orgasm as you can otherwise never become. Remember, no other experience is so deep and so absorbing. No other experience is so total. In a sexual orgasm, you are totally absorbed. Your whole being vibrates in it. The body and the mind both are into it. Thinking stops. Have you ever observed? Thinking stops completely during the moment of the peak. Even if it happens for a single second, then the process, and you are a witness to it, the process of transformation has set in. In a sexual orgasm, you are, being is there without any thinking. In this moment, if you can become alert and conscious, then sex can become door towards the divine. In that moment, if you become aware that something is happening, and this is not only true about this particular act, about anything which is created, the moment when the peak is going to happen in any act of creativity, you realize that the thinking stops, you are so totally into it. In this moment, if you become alert and conscious, then sex becomes the door to the divine. And if in that moment you become alert, that alertness can be carried in other moments also, and other experiences also. It can become a part of you. Then eating, walking, doing some work, pulling water from the well, carrying it up the hill, watering the plants, everything becomes alertness. Through sex, the alertness has touched your deepest core. It has penetrated you. Now you can carry its fruits wherever you are. Whatever you do, if that happens to you, the words that flow out of you become the mystical wine, intoxicating. The moment you keep on drowning this music as it flows, thoughts will start vanishing slowly and slowly. A different kind of intoxication surrounds you. It will keep you meditative, take you to a different layer. And if you become meditative, you will come to realize something new. That fact is that it is not sex that gives you the bliss. It is not sex that gives you the ecstasy. Rather, the state of thoughtlessness that comes to you, that gives the state of bliss. It is thoughtless state of the mind and total involvement in the act that gives you a blissful feeling. Once you understand this, sex will be needed less and less and less, because the thoughtless state of the mind can be created even without it. Sometimes you are sitting, you need at the beginning, in the beginning, the outside source to take you into that state of thoughtlessness. Then it becomes a natural process. The thoughtless state of mind can be created even without it. And this state, when without doing anything, you attain to a state of thoughtless state of mind, you have attained to meditation. This thoughtless state of mind is what meditation means, and that totality of the being can be created even without sex. Once you know that the same phenomena can happen without sex, sex will be needed less and less. A moment comes when sex will not be needed at all. You have not repressed it. Instead, this is the transcendence through sex, of sex. Remember, sex is always dependent on the other. So during the moments of sex, bondage and slavery remains within you. Once you can create this total orgasmic phenomena without any dependence or dependence on anybody else, when it has become the inner source, you are independent and free. This is the state of being celibate. Now you are not dependent on anyone. The ecstasy is the outcome of inner harmony, the merger of anima animus. Sex disappears through meditation, but it does not destroy the energy. Energy is never destroyed, only the form of the energy is changed. Now it is no longer sexual, and when the form is no longer sexual, you become loving. So really, a person who is sexual cannot love. He will always be doubtful. His love can only be a show. His love is just a means towards sex. A man who is sexual uses love just as a technique towards sex. It is a means. A sexual person cannot really love, he can only exploit the other. In the hands of such a person, love becomes just a way to approach the other. A person who has become non-sexual and the energy begins to move within has become ecstatic, and this state of ecstasy is like the autopilot in the plane. His ecstasy is his own. His ecstasy is not dependent on anything. For the first time he realizes love. His love will be constant showering, a constant sharing, and constantly overflowing. But to achieve this, you need not be anti-sex. To achieve this state, you have to accept sex as the part of life, of natural life. Move with it, only move with more consciousness. Consciousness is the bridge, the golden bridge from the state where you are, the world, to the other, from hell to heaven, from ego to divine, and that is the way to transform this basic existential energy into something that is the compassion of the Buddha, the love of Jesus.